I was introduced to Roma video games a tad later than most people. For most, if not all of my early childhood, I was isolated from other kids and I had next to no social interactions. My days were spent in a prison-like school and my nights were, well, rotting away my brain with mind-numbing television. Life was dull and boring, and all I had were my stuffed animals and cheap plastic toys to talk to. That's when I got my GameCube. It was the Christmas of 2003, I believe. I was overjoyed at having my own game station. It came with all the games, like Super Mario, Sunshine, Pac-Man World 2, and Pokemon Gentle. Each of those games still holds a special place in my heart today. As soon as the GameCube was set up and ready to go, I began playing it immediately. The first game I played was Super Mario Sunshine. That game got me hooked on the Mario series, I'll tell you what, after playing it for hours on end. And finding a level I couldn't get past, I turned to, well, Pac-Man World 2. Amazingly enough, I got stuck on the level there too. Infuriated that I couldn't find a way out even though the answer was literally right in front of my eyes, I quit and started playing my first ever Pokemon game. Pokemon Channel. As soon as I turned on the game, I knew it was going to be different from the others. It didn't take long for me to fall in love with the game. When the time came for me to name my Pikachu, I unwittingly named him Brever, short for brother. What compelled me to give him such a strange nickname that didn't even sound like a shortened version of brother, I'll never know. But regardless, I still enjoyed playing the game. There's no way for me to describe the love I felt towards the game. It was everything I had ever dreamed of. In this game, I had a friend I could play with, and it all took place in the Pokemon World 2, which I had already loved before Pokemon Channel. I could watch TV with my best friend Brever, go fishing with him, play tic-tac-toe with him, talk to other Pokemon with him, even grow a garden or build a snowman with him, explore ancient ruins, play musicals, sit around campfires, gaze into the stars. All the things I never got to experience in real life, I was able to do in this virtual world with Brever. The best friend I never had. I was obviously over-addicted to the game, but I had nothing else to do with my time, so instead I put all of it into this game. Oblivious to all things happening in the world, obviously, I preferred to live in, well, this Pokemon fantasy with my best friend Brever. Brever seemed more like than just a virtual animated 3D model forced to do his actions based on some programming of a game. He seemed real to me. If I was ever sad one day, he would appear and look and act depressed too. If I got angry, he would show and express my rage during that play of the game too. If I needed something to cheer me up, he would act silly and leap at me and do other idiotic things too. Later on, when I grew older and wiser, I just assumed that all these strange things and events never really happened. When I was younger, I just simply imagined it. But it was still fun to pretend as it was, well, pretend it was real. As the years passed on, I got more games and acquired a Game Boy, which along with that came more Pokemon games, where I could have more than just one single Pikachu. My interest also floated into different series like Mario and Sonic. After playing Pokemon Channel so many times and doing the same things over and over again, it started to get a little boring. I started playing it less and less, and other games more and more, but I still gave Pokemon Channel a play every now and again. Eventually, I changed schools, and my whole life changed. I was moved from a private Christian school to, well, a public school, and my eyes were open to reality. I started to learn new things about real life, which helped me enjoy it more. When people weren't mean and cruel to me, they would greet me and pass me in the hallways, and etc., and not give me those disgusted looks that other kids used to give me. I discovered I could do more than just play video games. I could draw. There were thousands and thousands of songs I could listen to, and my grades started dramatically rising. But the best part of all that was I got a new friend. A real friend. One with flesh and blood and everything. She was funny and helped me get used to school, and it was someone I could talk to besides my parents. We both had some immature, mock-everything attitude going on, but, you know, like great minds think alike. But I finally had a best friend. While I started to grow in both mind and body, Pokemon Channel was slowly forgotten, and I moved on to bigger and better games. Almost all the things I could do in the game I was able to do in real life now, and Brever was replaced by my real life best friend. He and the game became obsolete, forgotten on a dusty shelf in a dark corner of the room. For the next couple of years, life was golden. Each day I'd learn something new, and I had tons of fun with my new best friend. I made other friends too, but no one could top my best friend. Every now and again, I'd get a new game and get some money. Go and, eventually do that with my best friend. Draw something, or maybe listen to some music. I never wished for anything more. But sadly, good things never last. Eventually, I had to move, and I protested and threw a fit to no avail. Trying to stop the tears from falling off my face, I told my best friend goodbye on the last day of that school year. For the next few nights, I cried myself to sleep at my new house, but eventually I stopped, having one of my main reasons to live ripped away and torn out of my life. The hold on my heart could never really be completely healed. But the pain eventually became less and less. I still had contact with my best friend. We both had YouTube accounts so we could talk to each other over the internet. We'd call each other too and have sleepovers. And sometimes we'd see a movie together. But it hurt not to have her at school anymore. I made some new best friends at my new school. Well, new friends, anyway. Even more than at my old school, but none of them were as funny or as charming as best friend. None of them could replace her. Just when I thought I could get used to this lifestyle, one of the most dreadful things happened, and for her sake, I won't post what my friend did, but she did something horrible, and my mom refused to let me speak or see her or hear from her ever again. My heart was utterly smashed into 1,000 pieces. I felt like I had nothing left to live for, and my best friend, and what felt like my only friend, was now gone from me forever. I now sunk back into my old habits, playing video games and isolating myself from the rest of the world. I didn't go out anymore, and I refused to leave my room except to go to school, eat, or use the restroom, and visit my dad every other weekend. Now that my best friend had been snatched away from me, and that I didn't do anything in real life anymore, I needed something to replace them. Searching through my old ancient shelf of old video games, I pulled out Pokemon Dead Channel, and I brushed the dust off it, the cover. It felt like an eternity since I gazed upon the game. I inserted a game disc into the GameCube and grabbed my controller and waited to see and greet my old virtual friend, Brever. A tear fell down my cheek as memories flooded back while I stared at the title screen. After a moment of soaking in the old nostalgia, I selected the continue button. I eagerly selected the yes when the information appeared on the current save screen, asking if the information was correct. As the transition of Pokeballs rolled across the screen, I couldn't wait to see Brever again. When the transition was over, I appeared to be in my room. The normal cutscene where Pikachu is asleep on the top shelf and wakes up didn't play, but at this moment, I'd almost completely forgotten about that. The only thing on my mind was Brever. I searched the room, though he wasn't there or in sight. After a few moments, the deli bird that delivers goods to you, that delivers the goods you buy from the shop from the Shop and Squirtle channel was over. I smiled warmly at the sight, and I remembered that I bought something from that channel almost every day when I was younger. I thought, I must have bought something last time, and I had completely forgotten about it. Curious about what the, delivery was, I eagerly headed for the door.
Pika!
A deep moaning sound stopped me before I could reach the door. I turned around the screen and saw Brever climbing out from under the bed. He looked beat up and depressed. I'd never seen him climb out from underneath the bed before either, except for when he's searching for Pokemon Mini in the beginning of the game. When he turned and saw me, a shocked expression came over to his face, like it normally should. "Hey, brother, it's me," I whispered, even though I knew he couldn't hear me. Instead of a joyous look and cheering, "Pika, Pika!" He acquired an infuriated look on his face. I was a bit confused as to why he was angry, but I couldn't but before I could ponder the subject, another call from the deli bird called again from the door. Brushing the whole incident from my thoughts, I turned around and opened the door, and I was comforted when the deli bird handed over the box, and Brever smiled and waved as the deli bird flew off. A package arrived with merchandise from the shop and Squirtle. A message appeared on the screen, so I pressed A as the message appeared. I wondered what was inside as Brever leaned inside the box and took out the items. You got a Pikachu TVZ. The Pikachu TVZ has been displayed. A menacing and quite gruesome looking Pikachu TV was set up in place of the old Voltorb TV. It looked like a Pikachu facing towards you with his jaws wide open inside its mouth was a TV screen with its fangs hanging over the top and bottom. It looked like the skin was tearing and ripping apart at places, like the TV screen was too large for its mouth. I was a bit shocked as I looked at how scary the TV looked. You've got Red Wallpaper Z. The wallpaper has been displayed. I gasped when the wallpaper was put up. It was dark red like dried blood, and Pikachu's sick twisted smiles were repeated across it. They each were bright red and looked like they were freshly drawn with blood. I was beginning to worry, nonetheless. You got Pikachu Doll Z. A doll has been displayed. I winced with fear when I saw the morbid Pikachu placed on top of one of the shelves. He had an eerie grin as the Pikachu's on the wallpaper, except with longer fangs, and its eyes were small, rubbery and red, and dilated. The tips of the tail was curved inward like a hook, and it looked sharp. It also had sharp-looking claws and numerous dried streaks of blood that ran the length of its body. You got Pikachu Doll Z. The doll has been displayed. You got Pikachu Doll Z. A doll has been displayed. You got Pikachu Doll Z. A doll has been displayed. The same sequence happened over and over until the entire room was filled with disturbing Pikachu dolls. They replaced all the other dolls. Brever got up and looked around the room. He nodded with satisfaction as he walked towards the TV. I sat in my chair, stricken with fear. Even though it had been years since I played the game, I knew these items were never in it.
Pika!
A threatening and commanding call came from Pikachu. He was standing in front of the TV and gave me a glare. I knew he wanted me to go over there, so I walked to the TV and he turned it on. The report came on as normal, but to my horror, the screen looked like it had blood dripping down it. I changed the channels, and they all looked that way. I quickly opened up my diary, which, in this game, is the start menu. I then clicked on the TVS tab, and I chose to watch Voltorb TV, but as soon as I did, my diary closed without me even pressing B. Brever was staring at me with a threatening glare and shook his head disapprovingly. Brever turned back to the TV and changed it to the Fortune Channel. This channel seemed normal, except for blood dripping down the screen. Choose your cookie. The words drifted from the bottom of the screen. I chose the top tab like I always do, and the cookie floated towards the Chansey's hands and cracked open. Do you really want to know what your fortune is? The words appeared on the screen. I froze in fear. Something about that fortune seemed eerie. It appeared that the Chansey on screen was laughing. Brever changed the channel again. It changed it to the relaxation channel. Instead of the fluffy Mareep that greeted me were morbid Pikachus that looked like dolls jumping over the fence. I quickly pressed B and went to the center of the room. Normally Brever would turn around and motion me to come back, watch him, but this time he didn't seem to care. I walked over to my old painting. A beautifully covered Squirtle surrounded by a cute Pikachu border hung against the wall. I sighed of relief. At least one thing was still normal. I took a few moments to stare at the old painting, mostly because, well, I didn't want to look at the gruesome wallpaper or horrifying dolls. Brother is looking at the painting too. Chills went down my spine as that message appeared. Even though it's normal for your Pikachu to stare at your painting with you, when I pressed B, sure enough, Brother was standing in front of the painting. It seemed like he had a sad expression, like he was remembering long-lost memories. He turned to me with the same depressed expression, and he looked at me and looked like he was about to cry. I felt sorry for him. I wish there was something I could do to cheer him up. Brother walked up to me and asked me a question, which is normal for your Pikachu to ask you a question every now and again, but this made my blood chill when he asked. Brother wants to know if you still love him. It had an O for X and O for yes and X for no option. Brother has never asked that question before, and immediately I clicked circle. He smiled and bent over laughing. I was a bit confused due to why I was having a laughing fit. When he was done laughing, he looked back up at me with an evil smile, and a message appeared on the top of the screen. Brother knows when you're lying. He turned back to the TV and began watching it. By this point, I didn't know what to do anymore. I knew for sure that this wasn't supposed to be happening. I thought that maybe if I restart my GameCube, everything would go back to normal. I got up and reached for the restart button. When I pressed it, nothing happened. And I pressed it again, still nothing happened. The game cannot be reset right now. The message appeared on the screen, and my heart stopped beating for a second. After dumbly staring at the screen for a solid minute, I sat back down and I decided I would continue. You know, might as well see where this goes. I just looked around the room for about a minute. Other than the wallpaper and dolls and TV, everything seemed to be the same. I tried to smile while looking at the old Pokemon mini posters, but I couldn't bring myself. The normally cute and cheerful music seemed to make the room more dark and disturbing. It looked as if all the morbid dolls had their eyes focused on me, like they were about to reach out and grab me, then slowly tear me apart and devour my flesh. Brother wants to go outside. The message appeared on the top of the screen, but before I could do anything though, Brother went outside quickly and forced me to follow him. My breath caught in my throat when I went outside. The sky was blood red, and even darker red clouds were swirling around, strewn across the lawn were dead Pokemon corpses. I couldn't tell you how many of them there were, just most of the limbs are torn off and faces shredded and entrails everywhere. I felt sick, like I was about to throw up. Brother stuck around them and then turned to me and gave me an evil grin. He walked up to me and asked me a question. Brother wants to know what you've done to the place. I immediately clicked X. His sin grin deepened even more. He then walked over to the skitty corpses and threw it at me. Its body parts broke off and flew everywhere and bounced off the screen. After many agonizing minutes being forced to watch Brother toy with the dead body parts, he walked over to the garden. When we stepped into the garden, two plants were fully grown. Instead of fruits, the plant had grown Pikachu heads. Brother plucked one and started to slowly eat it. My lunch started to slowly rise through my throat, but I forced it back down. I tried to turn away from the gruesome sight, but something kept my eyes glued to the screen. After taking his time, Brother walked over and ate another head. Once he was done, he cast me a wicked smile and leaped out of the garden. Again, I was forced to follow. Brother was apparently done messing around outside and went straight inside. I was hoping that he was done and we could just, well, stay inside. I now much preferred the more morbid dolls over the body parts, but he wasn't done showing me the world he had created yet. Almost as soon as we went inside, Brother immediately went to the back door, and guess who was forced to follow yet again? When we went outside, there weren't any more corpses to my relief, but the sky was still this ominous red. When I tried to go back inside, it wouldn't let me. Brevor would just turn around and give me a disappointing shake up of his head. So I was forced to stand there. The Viridian Force bus pulled up and Brevor walked up to it without even me clicking on it. The transition played normally and the bus was riding over the map to the Viridian Forest, but when we got there, the whole forest was on fire. Dead Pokemon were laying everywhere, and as the trees wildly burned, their bodies were charred black by the flames. Brevor seemed to be unaffected by the blazing fire. He skipped over to the patch of mushrooms. They looked like they were bleeding. Brevor ate one without even asking permission, and gave a satisfied nod when they were done. He ran over to the bell that starts the Pokemon concert, but instead, Brevor was being surrounded by Clefairies, and he's surrounded by these morbid Pikachu plushies as well. Using the bells, he played the most haunting and blood-chilling tune I've ever heard. I was awestruck. It sounded beautiful, yet so horrifying. It was high pitch and almost made my ears ache, but I was entranced, and I couldn't really think to turn the volume down. What seemed like years, the play was finally over. Glancing around, Brevor seemed to be satisfied with the burning of the forest and headed down towards the bus. Again, I was forced to stand outside my house while I waited for the next horrors Brevor would inflict upon my eyes. I thought he would take the empty snowfall bus, but he had other ideas. He just let the bus pass on by instead he decided to take the Cobalt Beach bus next. Same transition, same horrifying scream. The beach was littered with pieces of corpses of animals and, well, Pokemon, I guess, you would normally find roaming around here. The ocean looked like blood, and floating in it were more parts of Pokemon, well, dead Pokemon. Then it became apparent to me that Brevor didn't like the other Pokemon. We then played a game of tic-tac-toe, but instead of rocks, we used internal organs as pieces. Brevor beat me by a long shot, although that was because I couldn't think straight, using entrails as X's and, well, O's being, well, surrounded by dead corpses. He laughed when he beat me, like this is normal and supposed to be happening, but then for a brief moment, a look of regret swept over his face. I felt a longing to reach out and comfort him, so I used the C-stick to pet him, but as soon as the cursor touched him, his normal, infuriated, demented look came back. He ran off to the fishing area. A little person called me, and then on... He ran over to the fishing area with a little person called me unwillingly following behind him. Brevor stood on his rock and threw his fishing line to the blood ocean. Waiting for a little bite, I did nothing, for there was nothing I could do. But then he turned around and gave me a menacing glare like I was supposed to be helping him. That's when I remembered the bait. I clicked on a jar labeled bait, but instead of like a chocolate glazed donut, I got a rotting brain. It was falling apart and covered in a greenish-brown mold. Yet, it was still throbbing. I quickly tossed into the ocean. Shortly afterwards, Brevor caught something on his line. With a great yank, a creature came out flying in the ocean. I swear to God, this creature will haunt my dreams. It looked like a oversized dark purple Magikarp, but it was foaming at the mouth, while green, acidic blood poured from numerous gashes along from its body. Multiple organs clung to many spikes that was sticking out from its body. Parts of it had been scraped away, exposing muscle underneath. Some of the parts of the muscle looked like they had been eaten, leaving bones sticking out. It flopped around and gasped for air for a while. Disturbing, gurgling sounds emitted from its mouth. I screamed when I saw the vile creature. Brevor turned to me as if he heard me and grinned. He slowly climbed down from the rock, taking as much time as possible to let the wretched creature suffer that much more. Then he started to eat the Magikarp while he was still alive. I screamed again, but I covered my mouth as my eyes were forced to watch the gruesome sight. Once he was done, he turned back to me and smiled happily with that damned playful smile. I couldn't believe. I just couldn't believe this monster was once my close virtual friend that I looked forward to seeing after every day after school. After that traumatizing event, Brever cheerfully skipped along the beach back to the bus stop singing, Pikachu! His merriment made the situation that much more horrifying. While waiting for the Mount Snowfall bus, Brever stood in the middle of the walkway and was staring at me. His face was blank, showed no signs of emotion, even though I knew he couldn't hear me. I whispered, Why are you doing this? A tear started to fall down my face. Brever made this world to please you. My blood turned to ice when that message appeared at the top of the screen. Brever created this sick, twisted world. He then gave me this wicked fucking grin that stretched from cheek to cheek. More tears started to fall and sneaked away off my face. The Mount Snowfall bus finally arrived. I don't know if I was happy at the sight or petrified at that thought of facing another gruesome scene. Some things, as before, innocent transitions are not so innocent sights. Frostbitten carcasses lie strewn across the ungloriously areas across a frozen land. Most were half buried in the snow. Surprisingly, there was no blood or entrails lying about. The area had the said atmosphere of a morbid, fucked up time. Brever slowly walked over to the client and Jigglypuffs would normally sing, but since they were dead, they were buried under the snow. Who knows where he took their place? Brever sang the most beautiful yet saddest songs I've ever heard. His harmonious voice sounded like violins playing the most tear-jerking tune I had ever heard. He had a depressed yet sorrowful focus on his depression while he sang the tune, which is just what the song sounded like. I couldn't control the tears that started flooding down my face where he sang. My poor emotional heart broken too while listening to the sorrowful, drenched melodies. After what seemed like an eternity, Brever finally finished. He looked at me, dead straight in the eyes with the most sorrowful, depressed, and utterly hopeless expression I had ever seen. I longed so much to hold him in my arms and comfort him, but he quickly turned away and ran towards the second half of Mount Snowfall. We stood in front of the ruins of truth for many moments. Brever just stood dead while staring at the ruins. Then he glanced at me, a deep, meaningful look in his eyes ran inside. It was jet black inside, like it was supposed to be. He used a thunderbolt to light the electric flowers, which just caused the entire ruins to light up. All the walls and ceilings with many different words written in blood, like, Why? I must die! Kill me! It's so cold. I'm so lonely. Where is he? Come back. Why can't I die? Brever walked over to the other side of the ruins. The true or false tablet stood. I was forced to click on it. Brever was abandoned by his best friend years ago to be replaced by a new best friend. And he was left to rot alone in this truly virtual world. True or false? I finally understood what this meant. All these words that were written on the bloods were all from Brever. This was all my fault. I left him. My best friend to die all alone. No, he couldn't die. Even if he wanted to, he was forced to be drag out his miserable existence over the years, and I couldn't blame him for wanting revenge on me. I fucking deserved this. Then I slapped myself across the face. What the fuck was I thinking? Brever and Pokemon Chill was just a game. I wasn't supposed to devote my entire life to them. They're meant to be created just to amuse and entertain the mind of a child. They weren't real. I took a minute to ponder over my last statement. They weren't real. I thought about all the things Brever had done to traumatize me and get his revenge for abandoning him for so long. Hell, this is way too fucking real to be just a game. I selected O for true because it was. I admitted abandoning Brever and leaving him alone just to rot. Instead, the tablet swung back, sinking into the ground. It glowed green, as if in approval of me. The screen slowly faded to black, except for Brever. He stood in the center of the screen with a tired, angry yet sad expression. I don't know what to think of him anymore. I hated him. I wish I really could kill him. But I felt sorry and wanted with all my heart to help him and make things better. Brever feels the same way about you. Those messages didn't shock me anymore. If anything, I was actually expecting it. After long moments of just staring at each other, I finally started losing it. What the fuck are you going to do with me now? I asked. Brever wants you to suffer the same way he did, the game answered. He casted one last wicked grin at me, the wildest, most grotesque thing I've ever seen. The screen cut to black, and after a moment, the title screen appeared. The continue button was gone, and I sighed with relief. The horrifying reunion was over. I got back up on my desk, and on it, it's a fucking Pikachu Z doll. Oh god, oh god, oh god!